Hello, we'd like to welcome everyone to the webinar today. My name is Alan Goldstein. I'm a registered legal services attorney and managing attorney for Disability Rights California, and I'm here with Todd Higgins, who's an advocate with Disability Rights California.
Good morning.
And we wanted to welcome you to our U.S. Chamber of Commerce Foundation Hiring Our Heroes presentation. And we're going to discuss ADA and other employment issues impacting veterans with disabilities. And we really appreciate the U.S. Chamber asking us to put together this presentation and to do it today. So as I mentioned, my name is Alan Goldstein. I work with Disability Rights California. I've been practicing in the area of ADA employment law for close to 25 years or more, and have experience in litigation and representing people with disabilities, and also have been able to provide advice and information and technical assistance to businesses who are dealing with issues about hiring people with disabilities and reasonable accommodations and other issues. And I'm going to have Todd come on in a second, and he can tell you a little about himself and his background. But just before we do that, I just want to know today's presentation is for informational purposes only. It is not legal advice and does not constitute or create an attorney-client relationship. But people are able to follow up at the end if they have questions. And I will give my email address at the end of the presentation for people who have follow-up questions. But again, this is a presentation just to present information about the Americans with Disabilities Act and employing veterans. And now I'll turn it over to Todd, who will go through the session outline and a few other points.
Hello, my name is Todd Higgins, and I work here at Disability Rights California. And Disability Rights California is part of a national disability rights network. Each state has a protection and advocacy agency, and we are the protection advocacy agency in California. I have worked in the National Disability Rights Network or Protection Advocacy System since 1990 as an advocate. I am a person with a disability. I lost my complete sight and as a result of a traumatic brain injury in 1983. And so I have some personal experience with the accommodations in the Americans with Disabilities Act as it relates to employment. My primary focus in my work is working with individuals who receive traumatic brain injury, and of course veterans are a population who, there are quite a few individuals who have traumatic brain injury who I've had an opportunity to work with in the recent past. So I'd like to go over an overview of, or an outline of the presentation that we're going to be presenting today in the webinar. So here's the session outline. Okay, first we're going to talk about why hire veterans. Then we're going to talk about the Americans with Disabilities Act, the basics. Then reasonable accommodation issues. Other ADA issues. Then we're going to cover some resources. And then of course, questions, and Alan indicated that he'd have his email address available for folks who had questions after the presentation. So hiring veterans, important facts to know. 80% of private sector jobs have a military correlation with as far as technical jobs such as surgeons, technicians, photographers, and many jobs that are in the private sector have identical jobs in the military, in the U.S. military. There's significant advantage to hiring veterans because of their cross-cultural experience in their military service. And then there's also veteran hiring program resources through the Department of Labor, and we've provided a link in this slide to that resource here. So the next slide talks about when hiring a veteran or hiring anybody, the employee may have a disability, they may have an apparent disability, a non-apparent disability, or they may acquire a disability while being employed. Therefore, it's important to know the ADA, understand the reasonable accommodation process, train staff regularly, engage employees, and then utilize tax benefits that are available for hiring people with disabilities. I think Alan.
Thank you, Todd. And I really want to emphasize Todd's last point. And as we'll discuss, you're not allowed to ask potential employees or current employees whether or not they have a disability. And disabilities are not always apparent. So we feel this information, while certainly applicable to hiring veterans with disabilities, is really applicable to everyone you hire who may have a disability. And the disabilities that a veteran may have are very wide-ranging. A veteran can have a physical or mobility impairment, a sensory disability, losing loss of sight or hearing. They could have a mental health disability. For example, PTSD could affect cognition. For example, if there's a traumatic brain injury or other issues. So it could be a very wide-ranging, and it's really important to know how to navigate the ADA so that you can make sure that your employees are effective and productive. Because what the Americans with Disabilities Act is designed to do is to help employees be more productive. And if you think about reasonable accommodations, many employers view that as a cost, but we'll show some statistics at the end that shows that the cost is really a very small part of reasonable accommodations. What a reasonable accommodation really is a way to help an employee become more productive to do their job better, which is something that both the employer and the employee should want to attain. So now we're going to talk some of the basics of the ADA and the ABCs of the ADA with a little picture of the Jackson 5 album there, but I will not sing. In general, the ADA has five different sections called titles. And we're going to be talking today exclusively about Title I, which covers employment. But just so people understand the other areas of the ADA, another main title is Title II, which covers state and local government services, as well as public transportation. And just so people understand, if someone is a state or local government employee, you still look to Title I of the ADA for enforcing their employment rights. And Title III of the ADA covers public accommodations and commercial facilities, businesses open to the public. And Title IV, the first three titles are the main titles you'll encounter. Title IV covers telecommunications, and Title V covers retaliation. No one should ever retaliate against anyone who has an accommodation under the ADA or has a disability. And Title V also contains technical assistance and other provisions. So in terms of who's covered under the ADA, and again, we're talking about Title I exclusively, Title I covers employers, employment agencies, and labor unions. And if there's a situation where an employment agency places an employee with another employer, then both the employment agency and the employer may have ADA obligations. And often in those situations, it's a good idea for them to work out who's going to pay for accommodations, who's going to be responsible for providing them in advance. The ADA covers employers with 15 or more employees, but for smaller employees, they may be covered under state law. Many state laws cover all employers or employers with 5 or more employees. So just because the business is small and not covered by the ADA, there also may be state anti-discrimination laws that apply. The ADA includes religious entities, although there are some religious preferences called the ministerial exception. But the ADA does cover employees of religious institutions with some limitations. And the Rehabilitation Act, which was an earlier federal law upon which the ADA was based, covers federal employees, people working for the federal government, post office, and other workers, and there are different reporting timelines for federal employees. At the bottom of the slides, you'll note we have a site there for 42 USC 12111. Those are to the federal codes. We also, the statute, we also cite to the Code of Federal Regulations, as well as to some guidance from the Equal Employment Opportunity Commission, the EEOC. You'll see that in the slides coming up. In terms of who's covered under the ADA, the term disability with respect to an individual means a physical or mental impairment that substantially limits one or more major life activities of the individual, a record of an impairment, or someone regarded as having an impairment. And also covered are people who have an association with someone with a disability. And the ADA was amended in 2008, and I think under the current law, it's safe to assume that most medical conditions will be covered under the ADA. And it not only covers major life activities, but major bodily functions, such as brain function, cell function, items like that. So I think it's safe to assume if someone has a physical or mental impairment that causes some limitations, they will likely be covered by the ADA. Part B, about a record of such an impairment. This, for example, could be someone who's a cancer survivor where their cancer is in remission, but they still might need periodic time off for treatment or for examinations. And based on their record of a disability, they are also protected under the ADA. And then finally, people who don't have an impairment that is covered under the ADA, but who are regarded by their employer as having such an impairment and are discriminated against because of that perceived disability, will also be protected under the ADA. And under the association clause, that covers people, for example, an employee who has a spouse or children who have serious medical needs, and an employer decides to terminate them to save health care costs. That could be discrimination claim under the ADA based on the association clause. And again, we have the citations there to the federal statute and regulations at the bottom of the slide. One issue that comes up a lot is drug and alcohol use, and it's a little tricky, so I just want to go through it briefly. First of all, not covered are people who currently use illegal drugs. However, people who have used illegal drugs in the past but have gone through a rehabilitation program are covered under the ADA, so if they need time off again for treatment or therapy or meetings, that should be something that could be a reasonable accommodation under the ADA. And alcohol use is treated differently than drug use. Both present and former users of alcohol are covered under the ADA. However, employers are allowed to restrict drug and alcohol use at work, even if someone is a user of alcohol, they still have to obey the reasonable workplace rules and regulations that you have, so you can prohibit drug and alcohol use at work. And drug testing is allowed under the ADA. These are not considered medical tests under the Americans with Disabilities Act. And we have there a cite to the statute, but also there's an ADA legal brief from the ADA the Great Lakes ADA Center. Which discusses specifically drugs, alcohol, and conduct rules under the ADA. And I just want to say a word. The Great Lakes ADA Center is part of a national network of ADA advisory centers set up by the federal government under the Department of Education, and they are a great resource for free advice and information under the ADA, and we have some information about them at the end under the resources slide. In terms of the ADA, the anti-discrimination requirements are discrimination may include denying equal employment opportunities, for example, failure to hire, failure to promote, wrongful termination, providing unequal opportunities, or unequal treatment. All can be discrimination. Not providing a reasonable accommodation, which is considered a fundamental statutory requirement, may also be seen as discrimination. And on my experience, this is where most employers run into issues. And I think it often relates to inadequate staff training. It's really important to make sure all your managers and supervisors understand the ADA and how to navigate it, as well as when new people come in that they're trained immediately. Because we've seen lots of problems where new supervisors come in who are ill-informed about the ADA and create legal issues for their employer. And under the ADA, discrimination does not have to be intentional. If, for example, you feel that an accommodation is unreasonable and deny it, that may not be seen as the intentional type of discrimination, whereas someone says, oh, you have a disability, you can't ever work here. That's kind of the textbook intentional discrimination. But even a mistake as to whether an accommodation is reasonable or not can be considered discrimination. So it's very important to negotiate the reasonable accommodation process properly, and we'll have some advice for you on that coming up. The ADA covers all aspects of employment, basically the womb to tomb of employment. It covers the job application and interview process, so even before someone's an employee, when they're applying for a job, they're protected under the ADA. It covers hiring. It requires that confidentiality be maintained. It recovers staff training. People may need accommodations for staff training, either alternative formats or a sign language interpreter or captioning on videos or extra time to study materials or to take tests or braille materials or electronic materials. All can be training accommodations under the ADA. Company events, the company picnic, should be accessible. All company events where staff are invited or required to attend should be accessible. Benefits and compensation packages need to be non-discriminatory. Advancement opportunities, we see a lot of situations where people with disabilities are hired into entry-level positions and then are not given chances to advance. People with disabilities should have the same chances for promotion and advancement as people without disabilities. And also, we'll talk a little about discipline and discharge later. Employers are sometimes afraid that if they hire someone with a disability, they'll never be able to discipline them or terminate them. That is absolutely not true. People with disabilities must follow the reasonable workplace quantity and quality expectations and rules. What employers need to know, if someone has a disability and has an accommodation, then you need to be aware of that as you go through the discipline process. And we're going to have some words on that as well. So I'm going to, title one of the ADA is Reasonable Accommodation Issues. We have some pictures there of different things. A checklist might be an accommodation. We have a picture of some money, and I think that's what employers often think about in accommodations. How much is it going to cost? And then issues like a time clock, and which shows that people may have modified schedules or other items as reasonable accommodations. So what are reasonable accommodations? The EEOC defines reasonable accommodations as modifications or adjustments to the work environment or to the manner or circumstances under which the position is customarily performed that enable a qualified individual with a disability to perform the essential functions of the position or to enjoy equal benefits and privileges of employment. And this is very open-ended. We're going to talk about some specific types of accommodations. But I just want to point out that enjoying the benefits and the privileges of employment is an important part of the ADA. So reasonable accommodations may include job restructuring. This could be, for example, if someone is not able to perform a non-essential job function due to a disability, that could be reassigned to someone else, and then they can be given a different non-essential job function to perform in its place. It could be I had a client with OCD who wanted a different work schedule and wanted some quiet time at the end of the day when the office was basically empty to do filing and other items, and that was seen as an accommodation under the ADA. It could be part-time or modified work schedules. For example, if a veteran has therapy 2 times a week and they need a modified work schedule in order to do that, that could be an accommodation under the ADA. It doesn't mean that the employer has to pay them for their time off from work. Employees still need to make up their time or to use sick time or vacation time, but having their schedules modified can be an accommodation. An accommodation may be reassignment to a vacant position. This is seen under the ADA as the accommodation of last resort. Really, it's only when an employee is no longer able to do their current job, even with a reasonable accommodation, then before the employer terminates them, the employer has a duty to see, are there any vacant positions that the employee is qualified for? If so, then the employee should be reassigned to that position. And then appropriate adjustment or modifications of examinations, training materials, or policies. And I talked a little bit about that before, just modifying your work policies. In addition to training materials, there may be, for example, if you have a no pet policy at work, you need to modify that policy to allow people to bring in service animals or possibly support animals as well. Some other accommodations may be acquisition or modification of equipment or devices. For example, someone who's blind may use screen reading software, which would read the computer screen to them, and JAWS is a very common one. Or someone with limited vision may use Zoom Text that enlarges the screen for them. It could be using Dragon Naturally Speaking, which has a typing program, a voice-activated typing program, so it can be trained to someone's voice to type what they're saying. It could be using qualified readers or interpreters, using a reader for someone who's blind if the materials cannot be made accessible, or using a sign language interpreter for a person who's deaf or hard of hearing. Making the workplace physically accessible, making sure doors are wide enough, stairs are ramped, things like that. Providing auxiliary aids and services, which is kind of a catch-all phrase, which can include interpreters or other services, as well as aids or other similar accommodations. And it's important to know that this list is not exhaustive. Any workplace modification that assists a person with a disability in performing their essential job functions can be a reasonable accommodation under the ADA. And one important concept under the ADA is essential job functions. I've mentioned this before. These are defined as fundamental job duties, and employers are not required to reallocate essential job functions. They need to accommodate those functions, but they don't need to give them away to someone else. They may choose to do so, but it's not required. And then how do you tell what is an essential job function? Well, employers often like to look to job descriptions, and those are evidence as to what may be an essential function, but are not determinative. As many of you know, the job we're hired to do is different than the job we start doing, which is then different than the job we're doing 1 month, 6 months, or a year later. And unless the job description is constantly updated, it might not accurately reflect the work that's currently being done. So you look at what other people with the same job title are doing, what does this person do in their job day in or day out, to ascertain what are essential job functions. And the tip here is to always have current job descriptions to make it easier to tell what is an essential job function. And there's a cite at the bottom to the Code of Federal Regulations, as well as the EEOC Enforcement Guidance on Reasonable Accommodation and Undue Hardship. I encourage all employers to be familiar with that EEOC guidance. It's very helpful for navigating the ADA. And another question that employers always want to know, where does the duty to accommodate end? What are the limitations on reasonable accommodations? A reasonable accommodation or an accommodation does not have to be provided if it is unreasonable, which would be requiring the reallocation of essential job functions, or even if you give it to the employee, it won't allow them to be qualified. For example, if someone needs a staggered work schedule and they still wouldn't be able to meet the minimum attendance requirements, then that might not be a reasonable accommodation. And an accommodation is also deemed unreasonable if it results in an undue hardship to the employer, which is defined as significant difficulty or expense, and we'll talk about that in a second, or if it results in a direct threat to the health or safety of the employee or others, then it might not need to be provided. And we'll talk about the direct threat issue as well. So undue hardship, as I mentioned, is defined as significant difficulty or expense. And we have some tips here that I think are important for employers to be aware of. Money will rarely be an undue hardship, as courts look at the assets of the parent corporation, not at department budgets. And when I'm representing someone with a disability, when a business says that they can't afford an accommodation, I feel that that's going to be good for us because I think it's going to be hard for a business to establish that because you look at the assets of the entire business. So maybe for a small mom-and-pop type of operation, then money could be an undue hardship, but for big companies, it will very rarely or almost never be an undue hardship. But administrative difficulties may pose an undue hardship. For example, if people need staggered work schedules, but that becomes hard to administer, or if there are other accommodation issues and the administration of the accommodations becomes difficult, that can be an undue hardship, and that's often a better argument for employers than money. Employers should always document any undue hardship or any barriers that prevent them from providing accommodations, and in the process should look at reassigning duties to existing staff, essentially non-essential functions, to see if other staff can handle those duties. I'll look at hiring temporary employees or alternative accommodations. And Todd, I'll let you know, employers do have some discretion in terms of what accommodation they provide. They don't have to provide what's asked as long as they provide one that's effective. And then the ADA definition of direct threat. So as I mentioned before, an accommodation does not have to be provided or an employee does not have to be retained if they pose a direct threat to themselves or others. And that's defined as a significant risk of substantial harm to the health or safety of the individual or others that cannot be eliminated or reduced by reasonable accommodation. And this is a very high standard for employers to meet. So one, reasonable accommodations are part of the definition, so an employer needs to look at whether a reasonable accommodation will eliminate or reduce that threat. And every ADA case, and I cannot emphasize this strongly enough, requires an individualized assessment. Every individual case must be looked at separately, and it must be based on a reasonable medical judgment that relies on the most current medical knowledge and or the best available objective evidence. So medical scientific evidence can be relevant, but fears, stereotypes, conjecture, all will not be relevant. And just to give you an example of it's a high standard to meet, I had a case which was a very intense case. I represented an employee who was in the mortuary service in the first Persian Gulf War, which, as you can imagine, can be very stressful. He would often be dealing with the bodies of his friends and comrades who were killed in battle. And as a result, he had post-traumatic stress disorder, PTSD. He was working at a job and had a friendship with his union steward, who was also a veteran. And one day he confessed that he was having some racing thoughts and was thinking of, imagined where he would set up if he wanted to go on a shooting spree at work, and said some very, you know, things that can be very troubling. And based on those statements, the employer terminated him immediately, which was probably, or I think under the circumstances, was too extreme a reaction. Because what happened is the employee went, he realized he was in crisis, he had treatment for a period of time, and then his doctor wrote a note saying he is able to work, he is not a threat to himself or others, and the employer refused to accept that note and to reinstate him to his employment. And then we filed an ADA claim, and actually the union also was involved, and through the grievance process, the union was able to get the employee reinstated because the medical evidence showed he was not a direct threat to the health or safety of others. While those types of threatening statements can certainly cause alarm and are certainly grounds for investigating further, I think here the employer's mistake was terminating the employee, refusing their medical evidence, and taking that hard line. So I think that case demonstrates what a high level it is for employers to meet direct threat as a defense to the ADA. And with that, I'm going to turn it over with Todd to talk a little bit more about the reasonable accommodation process.
Hi, everybody. So we're going to talk, again, we're in Title I of the ADA. We're going to talk about the reasonable accommodation process. This is a very important process for providing effective accommodations for people with disabilities. And as I said, I've been a person with a disability in the workforce for almost 25 years. So I've used this process many times and understand how it can work very effectively so I can complete the essential job duties of my own job. So the process really requires a few things. First is an individualized assessment. Each case really needs to be looked at as an individualized case. Every person has their individual needs. You know, every person with a particular disability, whether it be blindness or PTSD, doesn't have necessarily the same needs. So every case really needs to be looked at individually. And so that's a really, really key requirement is to get that individualized assessment. So each situation is assessed on an individualized basis. So really, the tip here is just don't make decisions based on stereotypes or other people you know with the same disability. Really look at the individual that's in front of you, the employee that's in front of you that you need to accommodate. Okay, the first step in the reasonable accommodation is the actual request for an accommodation. And so the process usually starts with a request from the employee. The request need not be in writing. That's the first thing to know. Employers can follow up a verbal accommodation request with a confirmation in writing of the request for reasonable accommodation. There's no specific language that's required that be used in a request for reasonable accommodation. A third party may make the request for an accommodation. So there's EOC enforcement guidance on reasonable accommodation and undue hardship, which is very helpful. Again, I think it's the requirement here is pretty broad for identifying the need for someone to have a reasonable accommodation, and once that need's identified, I think it's a good suggestion to, if it's not in writing from the employee, to put it in writing back, you know, to confirm the request in writing to create a paper trail. That's always a good thing to do. So the request for reasonable accommodation. Okay, what the request should describe. The nature of the disability and resulting limitations. What is the need for the accommodation? What is the requested accommodation, if known? So really, the tip here is consider a request for a workplace adjustment as a request for a reasonable accommodation. That's a good general rule to use. And then the EOC guidance for a reasonable accommodation is, again, cited on this slide as well. This next slide talks about the interactive process. And this is a very important part of the reasonable accommodation process. It's a really good opportunity for employers to get information about from the employee about what their need is and what might make sense in providing accommodation for them. So an informal interactive process should follow the accommodation request. The employee's preference for an accommodation gets primary consideration. That doesn't mean that the requested accommodation has to be given to the employee, but that request should get primary consideration. And so the really important point is here that employers must provide effective accommodations, not necessarily the requested. So if there's an effective accommodation, that's more readily achievable for the employer to provide. They can consider that in providing it. And this interactive process really allows that negotiation to take place with the employee. The duty to accommodate is ongoing, and following up on effectiveness is ongoing. And as I said, from my own experience, my supervisor and I meet at least annually to discuss my accommodation plan, but really, in actuality, when we meet monthly, we discuss if there's any adjustments that need to be made to my accommodation plan, what's going on, has there been some change in my job duties that would require additional accommodations or a change in my accommodation plan. So again, it's important for supervisors to follow up regularly with employees who have accommodation plans to make sure that those plans are effective and they don't need to be adjusted. So an unreasonable delay in providing an accommodation could result in a discrimination claim. So the tip here is always engage in the interactive process and again, engage the employee in that process to ensure that there's effective communication going on around the need for accommodation and what accommodation is going to be provided. So here's the interactive process. We're going to talk about medical information. I think Alan's going to cover this section as well.
Yes. So, all right.
Thank you, Todd.
So before I talk about the interactive process, I just want to mention a few things that Todd hit on, which I think are very important points. The individualized assessment is key. It needs to be done in every case. From the Supreme Court on down, courts have pretty consistently held to that requirement. And an employer shouldn't say, oh, we had someone with depression before, and it just doesn't work here if someone has depression. You cannot make those generalizations. And then the interactive process is really important as well. But just a couple of cases that have come up in terms of an individualized assessment that we've seen. I had a case with a veteran who lost his legs and drove using hand controls and wanted a job as a taxi driver, and the taxi company outright refused to hire him. They refused to provide hand controls, and they even refused to allow him to use his own hand controls. They never tested him to see if he was a safe driver. They just assumed, based on the fact that he used hand controls and didn't have legs, that he couldn't drive safely and couldn't drive a taxi. And we were able to advocate for that individual to get their taxi license or certificate, as well as to get the employer to provide the hand controls for them. In a similar case we saw, and I'm not sure if it was a veteran or not, was another individual who had amputations and had a prosthetic leg and wanted a job as a bus driver. And one of the conditions of the bus driver is you had to be able to jump off the back of the bus and help move students out and things like that. And we understand that can certainly be part of the job of a school bus driver. But again, this individual had prosthetic legs, very state-of-the-art prosthetic legs. So they were very able to maneuver and be mobile. And again, the employer refused to even interview them or give them a chance to show what they could do with their prosthetic leg and that they could meet the essential job requirements, again, based on stereotypes and generalizations. So you always need to do that individualized assessment. Never assume that because someone has a disability that they're unable to perform the job. Now turning to the interactive process. And again, this is very important. In my mind, employers sometimes often say no to a reasonable accommodation request, but in my mind, the interactive process requires not necessarily a yes, but a no but. So if someone says, oh, I need 6 months of leave as a reasonable accommodation to deal with my post-traumatic stress disorder. An employer may be entitled to say, depending on the facts of their case and their individualized situation, employer may say, we can't give you 6 months of leave, that's too much. We can give you 2 months of leave, then have you start working at home on a modified schedule for 2 months, and then try to transition you back for 2 months. And as Todd mentioned, if that was an effective accommodation, even if it's not what the employee requested, that may be a reasonable alternative for the employer to institute. And that would be part of an interactive process. It's not no, it's no, but we can do this instead. So as part of the interactive process, employers may request medical information if the disability or the accommodation need is not known or obvious. If you have a veteran who uses a wheelchair due to their disability and they need their desk raised up, you don't get medical information for that because their need for the accommodation is obvious. If you're an employee who you did not know has depression or post-traumatic stress disorder and then they need leave to deal with their medical condition, in that case you're entitled to limited medical information because you did not know about the disability or the accommodation need. However, the request for medical information should be limited in scope and must be job-related and consistent with business necessity. This usually means you cannot ask for an employee's complete medical records. They must be very, very limited to the accommodation request and the disability that the employee is putting forth for that accommodation. And on the other hand, if an employer is justified in asking for medical information, then it's incumbent on the employee to provide it. So employees also have a duty to engage in the interactive process. It's not a one-way street, it's a two-way street. So employees must comply with reasonable requests. And if employers feel the information they get is vague or contradictory or incomplete, then again, rather than just saying no, they should seek clarification or more complete information. And we have a site at the bottom of the slide to the U.S. Code, the federal statute of the ADA, as well as a different piece of EEOC guidance, this one on disability-related inquiries and medical examinations under the ADA. One thing that's key is that all medical information must be kept confidential. Some employers say, I want to know what my employee's medication is, what they're taking, what conditions they've had, if they've been hospitalized. I don't think that's a good approach, because anytime you get medical information, you have a whole host of duties that come with that information and potential liability if the information's not protected. So under the ADA, all medical information must be kept confidential in a separate locked location from the personnel file, and only staff who need to know should have access to it. In addition to the ADA, there's other federal laws that apply to confidentiality. There's HIPAA, for example. And there's also state laws that may apply to confidentiality. And any misuse or violation of confidentiality can lead to liability by the employer. So I think, in terms of employers, less is more. The less information you have, the lower your risk of violating confidentiality or other laws. And again, discrimination can only be found for known disabilities. So if an employer has medical information about a disability, even if they end up not discriminating based on that disability, there may be a claim because the employer knew of the disability if there is some disability-related aspect that comes out. So again, if employers don't need to know about a disability, I think it's a safer position to not seek any information. And one other tip we have here, part of the interactive process, what you don't want is one manager denying an accommodation to someone when a different manager in a different department granted a very similar accommodation. You don't want that type of inconsistency in the workplace. And one tip we have is centralized decision-making through human resources, utilizing, of course, accessible forms and policies is advisable. And again, the site down there to the U.S. Code and the EEOC guidance on medical information. And then we're going to just talk about some other ADA information, statistics, and issues. One, discipline and termination. As I mentioned before, people with disabilities don't have a cloak of invincibility. Employers are free to reasonably and consistently discipline or terminate employees with disabilities as long as they do it in an even-handed approach, you know, as they do with other employees. So rules and their enforcement must be evenly applied. Employers need to consistently apply consistent standards. The rules must be job-related and consistent with business necessity and be non-discriminatory. There cannot be a disparate impact on employees with disabilities. For example, a neutral rule that one worksite had is that all employees needed to have a driver's license for identification. A veteran who's blind might not have a driver's license, they might have a state ID. And if driving isn't an essential function of the job, then that employer should accept a state ID as identification, not a driver's license. It's a neutral rule. We just want a driver's license from everyone, but it had a disparate impact on employees with disabilities because not all employees with disabilities would have a driver's license. So even rules that on their face appear neutral might be discriminatory if they have a disparate impact on people with disabilities. And then what the employer needs to do is to modify that rule to account for the disability. And we cite to the code, and there's also a case down there on Raytheon Company versus Hernandez. It was an employee who was terminated for cocaine use, and then they reapplied to the job, and the employer had a policy of not rehiring people who were terminated for cause, and the court allowed them to follow that consistent policy in this case. reasonable accommodations and performance concerns, and this is an issue that comes up fairly regularly. So as I mentioned before, employers do not have to reduce quality or quantity expectations as a reasonable accommodation. In addition, forgiving past misconduct is generally not a reasonable accommodation for unknown disabilities. An exception to that would be if there was a known disability that should have been accommodated that wasn't. But in general, if you don't know of a disability, an employee violates your workplace rules, you can discipline them. However, if you learn of a disability, then what you need to examine is to whether reasonable accommodations will aid compliance with your workplace rules in the future, which might be extra breaks, time off for treatment, maybe a timeout just for a person to calm down and get themselves together, or it could be modifying procedures or other job functions. But again, under the ADA, tolerating abusive or violent behaviors is not required. However, if there are accommodations that can eliminate or reduce those behaviors, then those reasonable accommodations need to be examined. And the EEOC enforcement guidance is at the bottom with a link to the guidance. So at the end, we have a few other issues and tips I wanted to put out there because I think they're really important takeaways from this presentation. So one, avoid harassment and retaliation. So we've seen many cases of coworker or supervisor resentment toward accommodated workers, whether it's other workers who are upset that someone gets to leave early or take extra breaks or start late or have other accommodations. Just like sexual harassment, which employers are generally very good about training, disability harassment is equally serious and equally problematic and should be addressed the same way. If an employee feels they're being harassed or retaliated against, then they need to report it to their supervisor, or if it's your supervisor who's doing the harassing, then to go to their supervisor's supervisor and to make sure that the employer is aware of this, and then the employer needs to take steps to make sure it stops. One issue we haven't discussed is pre-employment tests. We see this a lot for entry-level positions, whether it's bagging groceries in a supermarket or working in a movie theater, you know, generally entry-level positions, but the tests don't talk about the position at all. Often there are these online, one-hour-long pre-employment tests, which to my mind seem to be getting at some mental health issues. They ask about how people are in interacting, whether other people seem happier than them or other issues. Very rarely do these tests seem to be related to the job, and I feel that they're trying to assess whether there might be some mental health issues because they might not want to hire people with mental health issues. So if you use pre-employment tests, I strongly, strongly encourage you to look at them. Make sure they relate to the job in question. They need to be validated through validity studies, and you need to make sure that the test helps you ascertain the best applicants for your job and not be used in a discriminatory manner. Another important point is to eliminate rigid leave policies. Almost universally, employers who have said you need to be 100% healed to return to work have been found that's a discriminatory policy. We're human beings. No one's ever really 100% well. You need to look at accommodations. There is no 100% healed. Another rigid policy that's problematic is once you're on leave for a year, then we automatically terminate you. Again, that's a rigid policy. You need to do an individualized assessment. What if someone needs one more week of leave, 53 weeks instead of 52? Then you need to look at that accommodation. So avoid those rigid policies. Again, as Todd mentioned, always engage in the interactive process. Assume most medical conditions are covered by the ADA and individually assess every situation and avoid stereotypes. I think we've talked about that at length, but a very important point. Looking at the work opportunity tax credit and tax deductions, there are tax credits and tax deductions available sometimes for hiring people, for example, who are on SSI or working with a vocational rehabilitation agency. You can get tax credits. You can also get tax deductions for accessibility enhancements, modifications in the workplace. So I generally think employers should take advantage of those. Again, we talked about centralized decision-making. Take personality conflicts out of the accommodation process. Make sure there's consistency in the workplace. I also want to let employers know there is no reverse discrimination under the ADA. You are allowed to have preferences for veterans or for people with disabilities in hiring, and that is fine. You can't have the opposite and say we don't want to hire veterans or people with disabilities, but you are allowed to have preferences, and someone without a disability who's not a veteran does not have a claim to say that they are was subject to reverse discrimination. Be creative and flexible. One, and I can't emphasize this strongly enough, generally the employee will know what the most effective and least costly reasonable accommodation is. In my experience, I have not seen employees try to take advantage of the accommodation process to get equipment or tools or things they don't need. So certainly utilize employee input and available resources in addressing accommodation issues. If they work with the Department of Rehabilitation, there may be accommodations that the Department of Rehabilitation can help pay for as well, and those should be investigated. Again, always protect confidentiality. Be aware that having medical information exposes you to potential liability. Make sure you protect employee confidentiality. And the last point is make sure website and electronic info, is accessible. This can include databases, your website that's open to the public. If you have an intraweb for employees only, that needs to be accessible. You need to make sure that all your information is accessible for the public and for employees. And sometimes that can be a vast undertaking. And what that means is then maybe you need to do it in steps. But when I hear employers say, oh, it's just too much, we just can't ever do it, that's not the right answer. Okay, we need a 3-year plan to do it. We need a 1-year plan to do it, depending what's involved. But make sure you start the process of making sure all your information is accessible. And then I have some statistics. I talked about at the beginning that reasonable accommodations are ways to increase employee productivity, and there's statistics that back that up. One great resource, which is at the end, is the Job Accommodation Network. Again, under the federal government, a free resource for employers to navigate the accommodation process. They have a great website, which has a lot of information, and you can also talk and speak with an employment assistant there to help you navigate the process. Based on JAN, the Job Accommodation Network, 58% of reasonable accommodations cost nothing. This could be a staggered work schedule or modifying job duties. 36% have a one-time cost, and a typical cost was around $500. And then again, the payback is what's really important. So 76% of employers found that the accommodations were very effective or extremely effective. And Jan previously had some info showing that employers benefited $10 for every dollar spent on accommodations. And that's a return on investment that's almost impossible to find anywhere else in today's economic environment. So I think this really shows how accommodations help increase employee productivity, which is something employers should want as well. And I have the site down there to the job workplace accommodation information.
And I want to really encourage folks to go to the Job Accommodation Network with questions, especially if you have an employee with a disability and you don't have a clear picture of what accommodation might be effective for them. Maybe they don't even have a clear idea, but the Job Accommodation Network is a great resource to come up with some ideas about potential accommodations to try to make that employee effective. So really, it's a great resource.
Yeah, thanks, Pat. Absolutely true. And we have a link to their website at the end of the presentation. And just what are the benefits you have of providing accommodations? Employers might say, oh, I don't want accommodating, let's get rid of them. I think that's a short-sighted approach, because if you terminate an employee, one, you have to deal with the termination and possible lawsuits, and there are costs and resources involved with that. Then you have to deal with the hiring process. There's costs and resources involved with that. Then you have to train a new hire to get them up to the level of the person who you terminated. There's costs and resources involved with that. And then a lot of new hires don't work out, and you might have to start the process all over again. So sometimes saying, oh, I'm going to save money and not accommodate someone, it might not save you money at all. It might be a big expense in the long run. So really take that longer view. Some of the benefits of providing accommodations are it allows you to retain a qualified employee, increase their productivity, and eliminate the cost of training a new employee. All very important benefits for a business. And then some of the indirect benefits are improved interaction with coworkers. There's been many studies showing how when employees see their coworkers with disabilities treated well, it makes them feel better about the workplace. It improves company morale and improves company productivity. And we've talked about some of the resources here, so I want to again emphasize these. One, the Equal Employment Opportunity Commission at EEOC.gov. They have the guidance we talked about, the reasonable accommodation guidance, and the guidance on medical inquiries. It's all very helpful. The Job Accommodation Network, another great free resource. I mentioned the regional ADA centers. They also can give information on the ADA, another free resource from the government. America's Heroes at Work has some great information about hiring veterans with disabilities and navigating that process and making sure you treat the veterans properly. And then we spoke about tax benefits available to businesses when they hire people with disabilities or accommodate them. And so there's a link there for all that tax information for businesses. We have some specific veterans resources as well. The U.S. Department of Veterans Affairs. The U.S. Department of Labor has a Veterans Employment and Training Service, which is very helpful there. Veterans National Resource Directory, the National Veterans Legal Services Program, and the National Veterans Foundation. Again, other resources that can help employers when hiring veterans. And there's additional veterans laws that apply that we didn't talk about. There's USERRA, the Uniform Services Employment and Reemployment Act. And again, all the veterans issues are under the EEOC, although USERRA is enforced by the Department of Labor. And just briefly, USERRA covers all employers and includes training requirements for veterans. And it may also cover veterans whose conditions may not meet the ADA definition of disability. And we have a link there for people who want more information on the Uniform Services Employment and Reemployment Rights Act. And then we have a little time for questions. And what I'm going to give people, I'll give you my direct email address, and you can write to me, or you can also write to Samantha Williams at the U.S. Chamber of Commerce, and you should have her email from the information about this webinar. And my email address, and my name again is Alan Goldstein, and I'll spell it out for you. It's A-L-A-N dot G-O-L-D-S-T-E-I-N at disabilitiesrightsca.org, and that's D-I-S-A-B-I-L-I-T-Y-R-I-G-H-T-S-C-A. .org, Alan Goldstein at disabilityrightsca.org. And I always like to ask people who's their favorite Riddler, so if you do ask me a question, you have to let me know who your favorite Riddler is when you ask. Well, you don't really, but I'm a Frank Gorshin fan myself, maybe showing my age a bit. And anyway, that concludes our presentation today. I want to thank Todd for presenting with me. I've really learned a lot putting this together with Todd. And I especially want to thank the U.S. Chamber of Commerce Foundation for engaging us in this and for having this program just to help employers navigate and feel comfortable with the ADA and hiring veterans. I really feel once employers get comfortable with the ADA, which is a minor transition, I think you can get comfort level fairly quickly. It just means opening yourself up to it and accepting it. I think employers will realize the benefits are huge in terms of hiring and accommodating veterans and other employees with disabilities. Any final words, Todd?
No, I had no final comments. Thank you, and I hope you found this information very helpful.
Okay, thank you.
Alan?
Yes, it looks like you stopped.